Hello, grade 12, welcome to Edu-ca-te. Let us talk about the theories of evolution. So now, just to recap, you need to know these following. So the evidences of evolution, we've covered them in our previous videos. Fossil evidence, biogeography, homologous structures, as well as genetics. And we also did the sources of variation, which is meiosis, random mating, random fertilization, as well as mutations. So if you're not covered on these topics, I strongly recommend you to watch our previous video. The link is in the description. So now let us get to a new thing now, the theories of evolution. So now we have got the first theory by Jean de Baptiste Lamarck. So Lamarck proposed the first theory of evolution. So it is known as the law of use and disuse. So now let us just look at the law of use and disuse. So we can hear the law of use and disuse, use and not use. So Lamarck argued that if an organ is used more often, then that organ will become bigger, stronger, and more effective. So remember that evolution just suggests that things have changed, okay? Even us humans, for us to be the way we look like, we came from something different. So what changed? Lamarck is trying to explain that. How did that change? He says that when animals used their organs more often, then those organs became bigger and they became stronger and they became more effective. Well, for example, here in this example, it is said that giraffes had short necks. So you know giraffes, those ones which have got long necks, but then it is said that back then they had short necks. But now, how did they evolve to become the giraffes that we know these days? So now, because they wanted to reach the food on top of the trees. So remember that giraffes eat the food on top of the trees. So because they were trying to reach that food, they stretched their necks. So they had to stretch their necks in search for food. And then because of this law of use and disuse, Lamarck says because they stretched their necks, their necks became even longer and longer. So Lamarck was just trying to suggest that if you use something or your organ, some organ in your body, if you use it more often, it will become longer, it will become bigger, it will become stronger, it will become more effective. So if you, okay, let me just make an example. If you stretch your hand, okay, if you stretch your hand, then it will become longer. Well, that's what the theory of the law of use and disuse is trying to explain. Not really that it is true, because it sounds not true, it sounds false, but that is what Lamarck suggested. And then he said, in contrary, that if an organ is not used, if an organ is not used that much, it becomes smaller, it becomes less efficient, and it might even disappear. So this is how you explain the law of use and disuse. But then these laws are just trying to, explain that if you use something in your body more often, or if you use something very much, then it will become bigger. But if you do not use that particular thing, it will become smaller, it will become less efficient, it won't work well, it might even disappear. So just like this crazy example that all the snakes had legs. So the snakes that you know, it is said that they had legs, but because they were gliding and they did not use these legs, those legs disappeared so that we could have the snakes that we have these days. Well, those examples are just theories. Remember, it is not really something true, but then for the sake of learning these laws, we should know the law of use and disuse. So the law of use, it is the one that is saying if you use an organ more often, it becomes bigger. And the law of disuse is the one that is saying that if an organ is not used that much, then it will become smaller, it will become less efficient, it won't work well. So now let us look at the second law that this guy proposed. So this is Lamarck maybe you wanted to know him, I just put a picture. But then the second law that Lamarck proposed is that is the law of inheritance of acquired characteristics. So since we have said that those giraffes which had shorter necks, they stretched their necks so that they can reach the food on top of the trees, right? And then when they stretched their necks, those necks became longer. So now you can just say that those giraffes have acquired a characteristic of longer necks, because originally they had shorter necks originally, but because of stretching, now they've got longer necks. So Lamarck suggested that those characteristics will be passed on to their offspring, so the offspring can inherit characteristics acquired by their parents during their lifetime. So for example, if I was to get into maybe my hand was to be cut off or something like that. So this law of inheritance was trying to suggest that my baby will also be born without a hand just because my hand was cut off. Well, that is not true, of course, but this is what the theory is trying to suggest, the law of inheritance of acquired characteristics, that if a parent acquires a characteristics during their lifetime, for example, this giraffe with short necks stretched their necks and they became longer, so they've acquired a new characteristics of long necks. So now Lamarck suggested that those necks they are like the parents of these giraffes with these new long necks, they will also have long necks, of which that is impossible. So now, for example, since the giraffes with short necks stretched their necks and they became longer, the characteristics of longer necks were passed on to their offspring. So this is what the Lamarck theory was suggesting. So in summary, Lamarck says organisms can use their organs more, and those organs will become bigger, stronger, and more effective. That is the law of use. And if an organ is not used that much or is not used more often, then it becomes smaller, less efficient, and might even disappear or not work properly. Yes. So, and then he further said that if a parent acquires a characteristic in their lifetime, then that characteristic will be passed on to their offspring. So now, let us now go to the reasons why was Lamarck's theory rejected. Of course, it's not true. Of course, it's not true, because we can see it just does not make sense. So now, Lamarck's theory was rejected mainly because there was no evidence that acquired characteristics by parents can be inherited by the offspring. For the example that I've made, that if my hand was to be cut off, it doesn't mean that if I give birth to a child, or maybe if I make a baby, that baby will also be born without a hand. I acquired the characteristic, but then it doesn't mean that if I'm going to produce another baby, that baby will also have the characteristic that I've acquired. So there was no evidence that acquired characteristics can be inherited. That is why Lamarck's theory was rejected. I mean, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense, because even someone who doesn't have, okay, let's just say someone who doesn't have an ear, he can give birth to someone that has got an ear. So it just does, it doesn't mean that if an organism acquires characteristic, it can be able to transfer that characteristic to their offspring. That would be sort of awkward. Yes. So this is just a Lamarck's theory of evolution, the law of use and disuse, as well as the law of inherited characteristic. And then the one that sort of makes sense better than the one of Lamarck, it is known as the evolution by natural selection by Charles Darwin. This is commonly accepted So this is a theory because it is commonly accepted and it is somewhat it somewhat makes sense. So now Charles Darwin's theory of evolution by natural selection says that there is a great deal of variation. There is a great deal of variation amongst the offspring. That is one mark. So if a question in the exam was to ask you, explain or maybe describe evolution by natural selection, just generally, you have to use these points that I'm about to list here. So now, according to Charles Darwin, there is a great deal of variation amongst the offspring that are produced. What does this statement mean? It just means that when babies are made or when offspring is produced, they've got a variation. Remember, we've talked about variation in our previous video. It means that they are different. Okay, the offspring that is produced is different. Just like when two parents make a baby, they can make two babies. One of them will be dark skinned, one of them will be light skinned. So it shows enough that they have got different characteristics. They've got a variation between them. That is the meaning of the word variation. So there is a great deal of variation amongst the offspring that is produced. And then some have got favorable characteristics and some do not have favorable characteristics. So now what does this mean? For example, as a human, I'm not really adapted to live in snow. If I was to go to an area that has got snow and not wear a jersey, I would die eventually. So I do not have a favor. It's not a favorable environment for me. So now, amongst those offspring, some of them have got favorable characteristics and some of them do not, depending on the environmental conditions. Because some of the animals, they can survive on a hot area. Some of the animals, they can survive on a cold area. So this is just what it means, that some of them, they've got different characteristics. Remember that there's a variation. And then now, when there is a change in the environmental condition, or if there is competition, right? So now, when there's a change in the environmental condition, for example, let us just say an animal cannot survive rain. Right now it is raining where I am currently. So that animal, when rain comes, it will not be able to survive. But an animal that is adapted to live in rain, it can be able to survive. So now, when there is a change in the environmental conditions or there is competition, what happens? The organisms that have got the favorable characteristics, or the ones with the characteristics that make them more suited, they will be able to survive because they are adapted to live in that environmental condition. Okay, so if an animal cannot survive hot weather and the sun starts striking in that way that it becomes very, very, very hot, that animal will not be able to survive. But an animal that is adapted to live in a hot area, it will be able to survive even if there are harsh environmental conditions, even if it is very, very, very hot. Okay, but then those organisms with unfavorable characteristics, they will die because they do not have the characteristics, they are not adapted to live in that particular environment. Okay, they are not adapted to live in that particular environment. Just like different types of animals, there are animals, for example, fish can only live in water. Okay, if you were to take fish out of water, what would it do? It will die. Why? It is because it does not have the favorable characteristic to live in land. It has got a favorable characteristic to live in water. That is why we say that the organisms with unfavorable characteristics, they will die. They will not be able to survive. And then now, the organisms that will survive, since they have survived, it means that they've lived, they've continued living because they've got favorable characteristics. So they will reproduce. What does it mean? It just means that they will mate and make more babies and create and produce more offspring. okay, because they've survived, right? They did not die because of these environmental conditions and that competition, but they have survived, so they will reproduce. And then when they reproduce, they will pass the allele for the favorable characteristic to their offspring. So remember that alleles are just variations of genes. Genes are passed on from parents to offspring. So if the parents survive and they reproduce, and they have that favorable characteristic, remember, it is the one that was able to make them to survive. So they will pass on that favorable characteristic to their offspring. So it means that if the parents were able to survive or live on land, their offspring will also be able to survive or live on land, because the favorable characteristic is passed on to the offspring. So that is what it means, that when they reproduce, or when these organisms that survive, when they reproduce, they will pass on the favorable characteristic. For example, if fish can survive in water, right, it will reproduce with another fish, and that offspring will also be able to survive in water because it has got that characteristic of surviving in water. So that's what it means when we say that the allele is passed on, or the allele for the favorable characteristic is passed on to the offspring. And then the next generation will therefore have a higher proportion of individuals with the favorable characteristic. So it just means that when the offspring has got this favorable characteristic, it will just, like, there will be much offspring with the favorable characteristic, because it has been passed on from the parents. So this is how you explain evolution by natural selection. There are a lot of points here. I think this is 7, if I'm not mistaken. Usually it is 7 marks. So now bear in mind that this is just a general way of explaining evolution by natural selection. So this can be specific. Maybe they can give you a question specifically based on certain animals, and you have to explain referring to those animals and not just generally. This is just general evolution by natural selection, and this is how you explain it. But then this makes more sense in explaining how then evolution takes place. It makes sense more to me than the theory that Lamarck suggested. And then now the last thing we're going to talk about today, it is the punctuated equilibrium. So punctuated equilibrium, it is just a 4 marks question. Whenever you hear them say, you should explain evolution through punctuated equilibrium, you need to mention these 4 points. So this theorem was suggested by Niels Eldredge as well as Stephen J. Gold. So now punctuated equilibrium says that evolution involves long periods of time. This is 1 mark. Evolution involves long periods of time. It just means that evolution takes a lot of time. Where species do not change, or maybe they change slowly or gradually through natural selection. But then you really have to mention this other point. But then you have just to mention that evolution involves long periods of time where species do not change. It means that species do not just evolve. Like, for example, as humans, as we are, let's just say, it doesn't just happen that tomorrow we will give birth to a different human. No, things like evolution or the changes take time without happening. So evolution involves long periods of time where species do not change, or the species change gradually. It just means that they change slowly through natural selection. And then now this alternates with short periods of time where rapid changes occur through natural selection as well. And then now this will form new species. So this will form new species. This is the keyword. So now this is usually 4 marks. Try to find 4 marks from here and try to memorize them. This is how you explain punctuated equilibrium. In short, it is just trying to say that evolution takes time without any changes happening. Okay. And then after that, this will be followed by shorter periods of time with rapid change, meaning that after taking a long time without no changes in the species, and then suddenly in a short period of time there will be rapid change, meaning that the species will change so quick through the process of natural selection. And then when the species are changing, it will form new species. So this is just evolution by punctuated equilibrium is trying to explain. I hope that this video was helpful to you, and good luck for your NSC exams for 2024. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to subscribe.